Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Okay. So you've not moved to Los Angeles, I'm guessing.
No.
You're not going to become a Hollywood director making a big crazy CG movies or anything?
You'll see. You never know what's written in the future, but I'm not planning that, yeah.
Does that interest you, or would you like to try that?
Let's say I know my language is limited, so my market is limited. And if we all believe is art is communication with audience, then of course I would like to have more audience and more to talk with. Mm. But just in the same time, it's as a contradiction, like I love to sing my song. So of course, if I have any kind of connection for a material, which can be a Hollywood big movie, then it's fine. It's just for entertaining or just to create, you know, those movies. I can't imagine myself.
Do you watch those movies?
Absolutely.
Are you fan? Do you like them, even though they're not really your?
It depends. It really depends of the topic, and it depends of which one. So I think it's huge differences in between those movies. So some of them are really have something more than just to entertain you or just a video game which is comes through your brain. And also some of them are more deep and have kind of a statement behind.
So what's like, can you name one or two that you like?
For example, Gravity. I quite like that movie. I think it was super innovative also visually. Like, okay, so I don't watch that kind of movies before.
Right.
And I think it's science fiction in the space after Stanley Kubrick is quite difficult to create. So, and that was something kind of an answer. It's a contemporary answer and a step forward somehow on an innovative way. So I quite like this movie.
Anything where anybody wore a costume, a uniform, like a mask or any of that stuff?
Like
comic book movies? Are those any of those appealing to you? Or?
I mean, it's from my childhood, I really like Hulk. And I like, you know, the Ang Lee's Hulk in that time because of the Green Man. And quite like Captain American. I don't know why. I just watched it on the plane and I quite enjoy it because most of them I just switch off. But I have two children, so I must go to the cinemas with them as well and to see movies. The first Hunger Game was quite okay, but I prefer Battle Royale by Takeshi.
Yeah.
And
the much more serious version of it.
Exactly. I mean, it's just, you know, how you can make it the same idea with Lemonade. And
yeah,
but that's also, I quite like the female character, just as a hero. And some others, I like Captain Phillips. It's a good movie, I think. It was really like well done.
Yeah.
And it's also like a double meaning that I felt, maybe I'm wrong, but it's criticized the US logic. You know, it was like a small black man in a very small shape and this huge power coming and try to destroy. And I felt, oh, so it's also criticized kind of the society and I quite like that movie as well.
So is going to movies at home like practically being in New York, or I mean, is it a lot of Hollywood product and a lot of, or do you, is there much home product that you get to see?
In Budapest?
Yeah.
Everywhere. Yeah.
It's so mostly like...
It's more difficult. I mean, I go to Paris to watch Art House.
Huh.
And not, I mean, you can pick up the main titles in Budapest.
Right.
But if you wanted to make and go deeply into the art house world, then you must go to Paris to watch movies. Which is close. I mean, in Europe everything so in Europe everything is close,
but it's a long Saturday night if you have to go to Paris.
Yeah. Exactly.
So what was the beginning of White God for you? What was the start of that journey?
Actually, I'm working on a amazing book written by Kötzi. The book called Disgrace, and I stage it in a theater, and there is a line with a dog pond, and which is happening in a dog pond. And I told to the ensemble, let's check the Hungarian situation. Let's go a shelter house in Budapest, and we all went there, and I was under the shock for weeks, just what I found there, and I even don't face any kind of problems like that, and I was like totally touched. And that was the period when I'm really looking for a theme and looking for a new kind of cinematic language, what I would like to go for, because I felt that Eastern Europe is changed and my reality is changed. So I cannot use the same cinematic language that I used before, because there is no, I mean, means nothing anymore. So, and that these two things comes together with the theme. And then I went to my scriptwriter called Kata Weber and to my producer called Victoria Petrányi to ask them, can we shoot a movie about a dog? And they told yes and no. And I asked why? Because of reality. And we don't, if you are make a realism, then it's better to make a documentary out of it. So let's create a fairy tale somehow. So Victoria gives the idea of the revolution and Kata gives the idea of the little girl. So then the whole fairy tale comes together somehow, and we all decided to mixing those genres together as well.
So did you look into other dog movies? I mean, there's my favorite is that it's funny because somebody reviewed your movie and mentioned, I think Manola Dargis mentioned a few other movies with dogs.
But
the one that I kind of identified with for this movie is Baxter.
Oh, right. I never watched that.
No, it's a French film.
Okay.
It's Baxter, Beware the Dog That Thinks.
Okay.
And it's about a dog, a pit bull, who is very happy with his master, but then a baby comes in the house, so he tries to kill the baby. And then he leaves the house, and then he's with a little old lady, but she smells bad, so he trips her down the stairs. And then he meets this little kid who takes really good care of him and has a very aggressive temper. But then he realizes the kid is a sadist.
Okay.
And then he has to stop the kid.
Okay.
And it's just kind of this journey of this dog, but you're in his head the whole time. It's all voiceover.
All right. I checked some of them. I mean, not really involved. I felt, you know, I have really bad memory of about animal films, especially the Soviet time. It was like really like, you know, you feel they are afraid. They just do the rules. And so, I mean, I don't know. I don't really watch them. I really would like to do my own animal movie, because everybody thought, please don't do it. don't shoot this movie. It's impossible without CG and all the conception we had. And
so the decision to not do CG was just about reality,
from the very beginning, because I felt, you know, I deeply believe equality. So it was really weird to imagine to use CG when humans' imagination about animals' emotion. I mean, it's illustration, and I really would like to shoot their own emotions, also because of the statement of equality. And yeah, that was the main conception from the very beginning.
So your script was together before you started trying to figure out how to do this, or did you
exactly? But then we start to cast, and then the rehearsals, and then we rewrite the scripts two times with the dogs. Actually, they write the script because something they can do and something they cannot do. So we build it up kind of a city in the countryside where we rehearse with them, and then we understand more and more each other, let's say that. So it was really like a lesson as well for me that, you know, just give patience and curiosity and freedom to them, and they gives amazing amount of power and energy and emotions back. But if you are a control freak person and you have rules, your own rules, and they do like this, it's not working. Yeah. It's really not working. So it's changed also my humanity a little bit.
Well, it sounds almost like Mike Lee with dogs. Like,
yeah,
you know, you go away with them and you figure out what they're, you know, improvise with them.
Yeah,
exactly. You don't really have a choice.
Exactly.
Till you understand what they're capable of, I guess, or what they're not capable of, or
I learn it.
Who they are.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And they have their own personality. I don't know 250 name by name, but I know 100 of them for sure. You know, just to work with them, and it was such an amazing ride. Sometimes, you know, in the set we just recognize it. What are we doing here? I mean, it's, you know, what we are creating, it took a lot of risk. Also, my producer told me several times that, do you know there is a huge risk? Do you know that it's you we can't know what comes out afterwards. Mm. And then in Cannes was our feeling that, you know, the audience really follows the movie.
Did you know who your lead was, your lead dog, when you started, or did you figure out which dogs? It was two dogs, I guess.
But they was chosen for the hero dog. So from the very beginning, I know they will be the hero ones. And it was a long process to find them. So I really need this Jolly Joker type of dogs, when you can believe also the very nice part when they are the family dogs. Mm-hmm. But also you must believe the white part. So I need kind of transmission in between the two characters. So it's a Jekyll and Hyde character.
But you would spend time with them like you would spend with the lead of a movie, if there was one dominant lead?
Yeah. No, I mean, they really do together, the character. Uh-huh. They are different personality, but not like he's the brutal one and he's the nice one.
Right.
It's much more like one is more gigolo type, more calm, and another one is more like this happy kangaroo, always jumping type. And you know, if you watch the movie, I can show you, it's just one close up to the next is changed, and you know, don't recognize it. They are so close twins.
So did you shoot them in the same scenes?
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Exactly. Both versions I shoot.
Almost always?
Almost always, yeah.
So you had that choice. You could tonally choose between the two energies.
Exactly.
As you were cutting.
Exactly, exactly.
So what was it like to go into post with this?
200 hours material just to watch again. It was really, really long, you know.
Were you comfortable that you had what you needed to cut together at that point?
That was really difficult to find the harmony inside melting genres, you know. That's also as I recognize it, that it's really like a unique twist and turns inside this movie, and how you can follow the ride, that was the main question. Emotionally, it's not just like, okay, what kind of movie you can edit after such amount of rushes, but also like how we can react our reality, where, you know, nowadays in the street of Budapest, if you walk to a block to another, there is easily happen a horror movie, a political satire, an action, and a grotesque, just in 2 minutes. So I mean, we would like to shoot that kind of film out of it.
You mean that has that kind of range?
Yeah, exactly. And you know, no ideology behind. It's just, you know, the old post-Soviet ruins comes together. It's like in a big belly, and they can. I mean, the audience follows much more easier sometimes than the pure genre movies, which is in my eyes quite dead, you know. Like, if you are doing very well, it still can be boring. And also when it's completely good in every way, then it can be still empty. So I have weird connections with the genre movies the past 10 years, because the whole became very conservative, no reflection to anything, because all genre comes from the answering kind of a contemporary questions or society questions, but that's lost. So I found it, you know, more radical stuff in the televisions recently. Than in the genre movies from America.
Well, it's interesting because the other movie at Cannes, one of the movies at Cannes that broke out last year, is It Follows.
Yeah.
Which kind of breaks through the horror movie genre.
Yeah.
Go someplace else completely. It's not.
Okay.
I mean, it still is a horror movie, but it's not at all.
Okay.
It's
okay.
Political and all those other things, I think.
I see. I don't watch that movie. But yes, I think this is somehow what is the audience looking for. Answering their own reality, and you cannot answer with that kind of empty cups. So you must find unique ways to catch them again, you know. And that was really personal from my side as well, what I am enjoying to watching. So
have you read people who were reading subtext into your movie that is off the deep end, that's not accurate?
Yeah, exactly. And also, you know, If you are dogmatically go for kind of genres, then you reject this movie for sure, because it's really like we need really free audience for that as well. So that's true. But I am an audience like this, so I enjoy that kind of rides always. I'm totally appreciate also from my young adult time or childhood when I watched the first Kurosawa movie or Fassbinder or those authors, or even, you know, these post-apocalyptic movies, end of 80s, beginning of 90s movie, when I was really like between 12 and 15, then those movies, those Hollywoodian movies, was really like uncountable for me. So it's like, wow, what's that, you know, which is just coming. And that's also what I'm looking for.
It's funny, because I was just thinking, Mad Max is going to Cannes.
Yeah,
out of competition, but it's going to be there. And it occurred to me that the whole idea of that series, that whole, is now much less subtextual than it was.
Yeah,
that it's like going to be a very different thing. The whole fight for gas and everything else.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Means something completely different 20 years later.
Absolutely.
And it did, which is like, it's a tribute to George.
Exactly, exactly.
So, do you like when people are conflicted about your movie? Is it a compliment to you when people are fighting to figure out what they think it means and what the different meanings are?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's really, I still believe auto cinema. I think it's really, it's an art form. I believe you use your emotions and you use your brain, not just entertain. So you're in the cinema, we are not just in the fun park. So I quite believe that, of course, on a very pathetical way, to be frank. So also I quite like strategies. I like to, you know, just to be touched, and you know, all of this topic is close to me. So, and something is real happen in the cinema, and it's divided audience. Yes, that's how is life is. If you watch something which have no answers immediately, or where you have no immediately decided what's your position as an audience or as a person, as a citizen, then it's close to something just to communicate for. So I quite believe it's like that.
And has it sped up in Budapest as it has here? I mean, the conversation about everything seems to be instant now with texts and Twitter and all those things.
Yeah.
Is that happening where you are based as well?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Everybody's living the phone.
Makes it harder though to
everywhere
to think.
Actually, I think it's everywhere. Also, even the most poorest country. I mean, just think ISIS. Mm-hmm. They are using Twitter and all of this layers just easily. So, I think that's really global. That's really global. Of course, the perspective of the audience can be different. So from where you watch this movie, for example, mine. So you watch it as a minority, like in Greece or Mexico and, you know, or Turkey. Then I felt that they are immediately follows just the dogs. Or that Germany, France, UK, they are watching this movie. Okay, we are the majority and we have responsibility for the minority. It's huge difference. Huge, huge difference. But it's also very interest me that the perspective of the audience and the difference in between cultures. Yeah. So of course there are a lot.
Yeah. No, it's definitely a lot of side picking these days.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether it's good or bad. It seems like, because it's gotten a little bit extreme.
Yeah.
Where there's no room for anybody else's opinion, I think, for a lot of people, which is frustrating, but at least there's passion.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's really the question of power and power politics, you know, it's less and less freedom. It's really lots of power comes from up. I mean, in my country, definitely, but I think all over the world.
So when you had days that you were going to shoot just human beings, or I don't know if you had those days, were those like, ooh, what a nice day, or relief?
Yeah.
Or did you get used to the dogs to the point where every day was kind of the same?
Yeah, exactly. That was difficult, but we'll see. I mean, I'm not planning to continue just with animals at all, of course. I mean,
you're not going to make Born Free next and the Jungle Book?
yeah. No. But we'll see what's the next.
So did it become easier as you went along with the animals, or was it just every time you had to go shoot a group of dogs, it was incredibly difficult?
No. It became much easier. I mean, once you understand the circumstances and you understand the method, what you can use, then it was easy. And then they give a lot, really. Like, I was surprised, even for at the end, you know, just how much strength they give for mm-hmm. that movie. And at the beginning, it not looks like that. At the beginning, like, oh. I mean, they do what they want and how we can react on that. And then when we find a way how we can react on this kind of freedom that we give them, then it makes it easier. And still, yeah, it was very tiring, very difficult. Also, the logically, just how you can shoot this movie. But at the end, it gives more for me than any of mine. So it's really like at the end, I know I learned something, you know, just also about myself, which is also important.
So do you think that's the material or the challenges of this movie or the relationship you created with all these beings?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's for sure is the challenge. And also what, I mean, how you can cooperate with another race, that's highly important. I was not a huge animal right fighter at all, mm-hmm. but now I am, and I totally agree. We share the earth with them and with plants and with everything, yeah. which is easily forgotten by humans. Also myself, easily, like, okay, it's mine, yeah. but it's not just.
Well, I think we've gotten to a point where we have enough time to consider things other than survival.
Exactly.
And the more time you have, then we've finally gotten to the point now we have enough time to actually consider how we're treating animals or how we're treating.
Exactly.
Which we never did before.
Exactly, and it's all about humans and all about majority. So, I mean, it's a movie about dogs, of course, but not just about dogs. And the main question, who's behind and what's in the mirror?
Mm. So when you were cutting, you know, the script had evolved as you spent time with the animals.
Yeah.
You go to shoot it, you go to the cutting room.
Yeah.
Did this movie change much at all once you were in cutting, or did you really know what you had?
Yeah, changed a lot, of course, but the logic of the structure is not changing at all. Mm-hmm. But how and what kind of gestures using for the same meaning is changed a lot. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. Of course, it's a different film. It's a better movie than we are planning, because we were flexible to follow them. It's mm-hmm. like a dramatized nature movie somehow. Of course, not the human part, but I mean, working with children, it's the same because they cannot lie. So also you cannot lie, because they cannot lie. So it's much more direct communication, and from a certain point, it was easier than with normal actors and actresses. Because then it's also like, okay, straight communication, but that can be easily cover the truth, so cover the real things. So there are, and in this movie you shoot always the real emotion and always the real thing, also with the children and also with them. And to find a way how you can do it, that was amazingly difficult. But when we found it, the method, then it's, as I thought, it gives a lot.
And you found other, like, shades of emotion inside of shots while you were in the cutting room?
Exactly. And also, you know, sometimes just to cover how you cover the happiness, that was very difficult because the dogs were always playing, you know, with us. And for example, a scene like a dogfight scene, it was really difficult to dramatize inside the editing room because there was lots of material when they are, because their two dogs was like best friends, and that was the logic. Because they are best friends, they are, when they meet each other, they are so happy and they started to play together. So,
it's like a wave coming on the beach. Sorry.
Yeah, exactly. But then we recognize it that then we shoot like 20 minutes every day. They are just fun together, mm-hmm. and then the next day 20 minutes again. So I shoot like 6-7 days every day, mm-hmm. their meetings, and then in the editing room we make a version, and then I do the close-ups, you know, with the fake blood and the sleeping and, you know, all this.
So you're really getting them playing.
Exactly.
And figuring out how it can look like conflict.
Exactly. Exactly.
Which worked better than you expected, or?
Absolutely, because I felt, you know, it's, but also with actors, it's like that. So sometimes, you know, to use your fantasy and use how you use your fantasy, it's much more important than to create a real fight between two actors and they, you know, kill each other or fight each other. And if you are not on the right place, it's senseless. I mean, why they are doing so. It's filmmaking. It's out of the question. Mm.
So when the film was done and you go to Cannes, nerve-wracking for you, or are you confident that you got what you have and the response doesn't much matter? Or?
It was really great time. I felt it's really growing because we took a lot of risk. So dogs, children's, melting genres, what's that? I mean, it's really like also for us to communicate to ourselves what we are creating, it was not easy.
Not to mention the title, which I'm still saying, White Dog.
Exactly, exactly. And then it was really great to feel at Cannes that the audience comes with us, really. And there was extra screenings and it's became a buzz and then we got the prize. That was really, really good. And it was really a good section for that. Mm-hmm. In certain regard, it's really the meaning of that selection is that, to find, you know, films like that. So I was two times in competition previously. Mm-hmm. And I felt a lot of shadow sometimes on my movie by the big sculpture surrounding, and that this selection was like funky for that for a movie like this, and the audience coming and they enjoy this unexpected way and they enjoy the twists and turns, and then so it was really like a great experience when we understand it that was so good when we took so many risks in this movie.
Do you get to have a communal filmmaker experience at Cannes? You get to like spend any time either seeing films from other filmmakers or spend time with other filmmakers?
Try to. Yeah. Cannes is not the best place to be.
No. Film festival that I know of. It's very rare that film festivals.
Yeah, but some of them as a spirit, but it's really a market, really premiere, really noisy, lots of people there. So I can't imagine just to make, you know, all-time friendships there. But yeah, there are some of them from my age and try to follow. I mean, this is my profession to watch movies. So I sometimes surprise so many film directors not watching movies. I'm the one who watch movies.
Were you a cinephile from the time you were a young kid, or?
Not really. I mean, I'm not planning to myself to as a film director, never. It's just coincidentally happened with me, and it was like that. But then when I had a memory back, then I recognize it. I think from the beginning, I patiently love cinema. I have huge connections with movies and but I decided to make art, and then I paint like 5 years when I was child, and never tried to be a fine artist, and I felt okay, let's make some course as an actor, and I was like 4 years in the university as an actor. And after 4 years, I recognize it, no, it's not my cup of tea. And also I recognize it and help and started to direct more and more to the others. And then I applied as a film director. And when I do my exam movie, that I was 21 at that time, for starting the school, I felt that's me. But it's clearly in that day I felt that's how can I can't know it before that. And that was really strange and crazy, but maybe, you know, somebody is in front of a empty paper and start to draw and they feel, okay, I can do this. So, I never learned it. I mean, of course I learned in the school, but it was not a strong school, and it's like I learned everything to myself through the process. And then I do my first feature when I was 23, and you know, and I do. Mm.
And it, do you know what it was that clicked in for you? Was it the whole, all the different pieces being together? Was it the being in charge? Was it the singular vision? What was it that?
I don't know. Well, I mean, it was really like at the beginning. I mean, at the beginning is I really would like to shoot with my friends, you know, and I was like passionately create without any kind of reflection what I am doing, you know, just do. And I think my early works, it's really from that soul. I don't even know the market. I don't even know how you can do it. There was no marketing. I was surprised something, you know, the young generation coming with what's that my rights and which festivals and so. Nothing. I mean, I was really out of blue. And then first time we sent my first feature to Locarno, and they selected, and then we won the prize, and I was like, okay, it's a festival. That's a festival? Okay, something like that. So I was so naively start. And still I thinking that, you know, the main thing you must do, and you want it to sing your song. If not, if you started to thinking about the market and festivals, it's never helps.
So do you have to push that away now that you are more educated in it?
Yeah, exactly. But you know, it's more and more difficult because the market rules and bigger budget, and you know, all of these things are on your shoulder sometimes. But I still believe auto cinema. I really still believe that, you know, just find unique ways. And I think this is audience waiting for as well. So always if they watch something which is new and entertain them, and also they can use their soul and brain, then that's the we all felt this is a movie, this is a cinematic experience. And yeah,
and as long as you can do that, you're happy. You don't need to be a huge hit or have $100 million or whatever. As long as you can keep your family happy. And
yeah, I think so. I mean, I don't want to be naive at all. And also, as I thought, you know, it's, I know all of the limitation for auto cinema, all of the limitation of my language. But if you miss that, then what for, you know, what you're doing for what? And of course I can imagine, you know, just have any kind of connection with different materials. So there are lots of huge Hollywood movie which is with the created with the personal touch, so it's out of the question. But just how you be enjoy that club,
right?
That's a question.
But you're not hungry for that. You're hungry. If the work is good and happens to be a big movie, you're happy to go there.
Yeah,
but
exactly. I'm satisfied with my life actually as a Hungarian author who's doing films on this way and doing other stuff, stage works, operas, all over in Europe. So it's fine. If something new is coming, I'm also fine. But if not, it's also fine.
Excellent. Yeah. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.